Posthumanism, research possibilities in Praxis with a word of prayer. I invite Dr. David Abraham Albert, Assistant Professor, Department of English, to offer the opening prayer. May we all rise for the opening prayer.
Shall we all look to the Lord in prayer? Most gracious and loving Heavenly Father, we thank you for the gift of this new day, Lord. Lord, we come before your throne of grace with a grateful heart for all your blessings and with a contrite heart for all our sins. Lord, it's because of your steadfast love that we are not consumed. Great is thy faithfulness. Your mercies, your compassions fail not. Your mercies are new every morning. Lord, we thank you for this great institution, Madras Christian College. Lord, we thank you for the Department of English, for the head of the department and for all the faculty members and for all our beloved students. Lord, we thank you for the TG Narayan Endowment Lecture. We thank you for the organizers of this program. Lord, even as we anxiously look forward to the 12th Endowment TG Narayan Endowment Lecture, we humbly request you to be with us and guide us. We pray for the speaker, Lord. Fill him with your wisdom and guide him with your presence so that all of us assembled here will be hugely benefited. Lord, in all that we do, let your name be magnified. In Jesus' precious name I pray. Amen.
Please be seated. Thank you, Dr. David, sir. Ladies and gentlemen, I invite Dr. Franklin Daniel, Associate Professor of the Department of English, to welcome the gathering.
Good morning. 12 summers have gone. 12 summers with a length of 12 long winters. And again, I hear these waters roar. There's an adaptation of Tintanabe, Wordsworth's Tintanabe. And I'm so glad that after a week of respite, we have managed to come here. I think many of you have been under the flood, but we're all alive and kicking. That's the best part. And most importantly, our program did not get shifted to any other day. There are so many difficulties in organizing this and getting this media center ready for us. So, honorable dignitaries on the dais, esteemed colleagues, scholars, and students, and my professor, Dr. Nirmal Selvamani, I accord all of you a very warm welcome. I'm delighted to have all of you for this prestigious academic gathering, the 12th TG Narayan Lecture. Today we come together to celebrate the pursuit of knowledge, the exchange of ideas, and the spirit of intellectual curiosity. How quickly time flies. And today we have a very distinguished person in Dr. Avishek Parui. A formal welcome will be accorded to him later. And he has consented to deliver this lecture. And I'm glad to say that we have been part of RAC meetings a couple of times. So this lecture is in memory of, it's an endowment lecture in memory of Mr. T.G. Narayan, father of Dr. Ranga Narayan. He's a remarkable person. And he's here in our midst. And it's no exaggeration to say that all these lectures he has managed to come here. That is the dedication that he has. And that is something amazing. In spite of his busy research and academic rigor, he's managed to do it. And not just this, dear friends. I like to say, just a couple of days ago, Ms. Usha Ramanathan, an expert on law and poverty, delivered the T.G. Narayan Memorial Lecture on Social Deprivation under the auspices of the Media Development Foundation and the Asian College of Journalism. Sir, we are overawed by this gesture of yours. And Dr. His dad, Mr. Ranga Narayan, was a war correspondent with a Hindu. And not just that, he also covered the Bengal famine. So I think more will be said in due course, but let me welcome you as we have all gathered here to listen to this amazing talk by Dr. Avishek Parui. I wish everyone an inspiring and productive time at this academic gathering. May we leave here with the insights, lasting connections, and a renewed commitment to the pursuit of knowledge. Thank you once again.
Thank you, sir. Ladies and gentlemen, the T.G. Narayanan Endowment Lecture is made possible by the benevolence of Dr. Ranganarayanan. He's the son of Mr. T.G. Narayanan, in whose honor this endowment has been instituted. Dr. Ranganarayanan is a distinguished professor and William and Tracy Cirioli term professor at the Department of Chemical Engineering, University of Florida, United States. He has nearly 20 awards and international fellowships and many, many, many papers and publications to his credit. On behalf of all of you, I invite Dr. Ranganarayanan to introduce Mr. T.G. Narayanan.
Thank you very much for those generous words. I want to thank the organizing committee of the Madras Christian College and the members of this audience for giving me this opportunity to say a few words about the late Mr. T.G. Narayanan and why we have chosen to make this endowment that bears his name. So a little bit of history. Mr. Narayanan was born on June the 9th, 1911, in the temple town of Kumbakonam. His parents were of moderate means, and his early schooling was at the Hindu High School in Madras. It was followed by higher education at the Madras Christian College in Georgetown, and then the Madras Presidency College, where he completed an honors in English. After a few years of being a school teacher of English in Alwar, Narayanan served at All India Radio and then joined the Hindu. He was best known for his years as a war correspondent, during which he covered the Imphal front and the war in Southeast Asia. Narayanan also worked substantially on the famine that overtook Bengal. It was a devastating famine that took over well over 2 million lives. He saw deprivation firsthand, reported on it, and then wrote a book called The Famine Over Bengal, with a foreword by Vijayalakshmi Pandit, and which had described the horrors and the cause of the famine. Towards the end of the war, T.G. Narayanan was stationed in Delhi, and there he spent several months interviewing many of the nation's freedom fighters. After the war, T.G. Narayanan joined the United Nations at the behest of Pandit Nehru as the chief of the Asiatic Division. He was then associated with the War Commission on Germany, the Freedom of Indonesia from the Dutch, and his final years, he was the personal representative and the Deputy Secretary General to Dag Hammarskjöld, who was the Secretary General at that time, on nuclear disarmament. It was called the 18 Nation Conference in Geneva, out of which finally came a nuclear test ban treaty between the Soviets and the United States. He has spent many years as a journalist, and he would say that those were the best years of his life. And because of his abiding interest in social thought and literature, we thought it was fitting that we remember him by instituting these lectures at his alma mater. The Madras Christian College is noted for its training and education of some of the finest minds of the country and leaders of this country. And my father would have been very proud to have his name associated with these series of lectures. This will be the 12th of a series that has been endowed. The Department of English has always done a superb job in arranging these lectures. We look forward to this lecture today by Dr. Parui on memory. We also look forward to the Q&A that's going to follow, and I'm sure many students will have questions. It's always quite enjoyable to see those. So thank you very much once again for having this. I also thank the speaker for having accepted the invitation. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. The life story of Mr. T.G. Narayanan is truly an inspiration to all of us. And before I proceed, I would like to welcome our former professor, Cherian Kurian, sir. May we give a round of applause and welcome, sir. Thank you, sir, for your presence here. The first woman to lead one of the oldest departments in India, Dr. Meghala Rajan Ma'am, is power, compassion, brilliance, talent, eloquence, and humor all rolled into one visionary whose remarkable leadership has introduced a wide range of activities, promoted inclusivity, and brought significance and a lot of achievements in terms of innovative programs and publications. And before I invite ma'am to take over to introduce our chief guest, may I welcome our former head of the department, Professor Dr. Ganesh, sir. May we give a round of applause welcoming, sir. Thank you, sir, for your presence here. Now, may I invite our beloved ma'am to introduce our chief guest. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you so much, Dr. Phoebe, for those kind words, which also frightened me a little. Well, it's my proud privilege to introduce the chief guest, Dr. Avishek Parui. I should thank Dr. Rufus for putting me across to Dr. Archana, head Anna Adish College for Women. And she was the one who got across to Dr. Avishek and then even promised me that sir will definitely come. And he's with us here today. And yes, I shared this information that we have invited sir for this endowment lecture. And I got a couple of responses, and they mentioned that he's an amazing speaker, an eminent scholar, phenomenal and outstanding, and a person with deep insight. Sir, we are privileged to have you here with us. And I would like to add something to this, and that is, I think the level of tolerance that he possesses is really high. Because in the first mail that I sent to him, I christened him as Dr. Abhishek. And he was very gentle and kind and asked me to send another mail to him. I find that when people are addressed, where the names are misspelled or mispronounced, they really take it to heart. And they won't be as pleasant as how sir had responded to this incident. I also have to add that this was a real blunder, and I don't know how it really happened, and sir managed it so well. There were further blunders too, because sir had been discussing about one invite and I had been thinking about this invite. So he was talking about offline and I said it can be online also. And there was a lot of confusion when finally I found that I had not seen the earlier invite that he had sent. Now, I find that sir is well-versed in the interplay of visibility and invisibility and is certainly equipped in disaster management of this kind. Now, to quote from his article on mending the metropolis, before I quote, I would like to add how it actually influenced me. It was a mind-blowing article, and the impact it had on me was really great. There were apt words that worked wonders, and ideas simply cascaded comfortably to convince and construct reality. They swiftly released very powerful ideas, and I found that they can actually ravish our minds, plundering in order to infuse possibilities. Now, to quote his words, open quotes, such psychic and social situations may be uniquely encoded and addressed with ethics and empathy through the cognitive interiority and symbolic instrumentality afforded by the affective and liminal framework of aesthetic activity, close quote. True to the topic, possibilities and praxis. The practices have been really professed well, and he had executed it efficiently. That is authenticity. Now, moving on to his incredible credentials, Dr. Avishek Parui is Associate Professor in English in the Department of Humanities and Social Sciences, IIT Madras, and an Associate Fellow of the UK Higher Education Academy. He has authored two books, Postmodern Literatures in 2018 and Culture and the Literary Matter, Metaphor, Memory in 2022, and is currently contracted with Brill to edit the Handbook of Indian Memory Studies. Dr. Parui is the principal investigator and faculty coordinator of the Center for Memory Studies at IIT Madras and member of the advisory board for the International Memory Studies Association. He is the founding chairperson of the Indian Network for Memory Studies, the only national network on memory studies in Asia under the aegis of MSA. Dr. Parui has been awarded the Global Fellowship from the University of St. Andrews for his work in memory studies and the Institute of Advanced Studies Fellowship from Durham University, UK. Along with his academic engagements, Dr. Parui is also a published writer of short fiction trained and certified by the British Council. We are truly blessed to have him with us today. And the lecture on memory studies will create memories and regulate lives. Thank you. Thank you so much. I'm happy to see my professors, Professor Terian Kurian and Dr. Nirmal Selvamani, and my former head, Dr. Ganesh. So happy that you are here with us, sirs.
Thank you very much, ma'am. Friends, it is time to honor the dignitaries who are seated in the dais and also our teachers who are seated here. Thank you so much for making it today. I'm going to request Dr. Ann Thomas, Associate Professor of English and also Warden of Barnes Hall, to honor the speaker, Dr. Avishek Parui, with a memento. Thank you, ma'am. I'm going to request Dr. David Wesley, Assistant Professor of the Department of English, to honor Dr. Ranganarayan. Thank you. I invite Dr. Samuel Jayakumar to honor our former teacher, Dr. Nirmal Selvamani. Thank you, sir. I invite Professor Deepa Priyadarshini to honor Dr. C.K., Dr. Chirian Kurian.
I don't know why she's leaving or where she's gonna go.
invite Professor Mohan Singh Daniel to hand over the memento to Dr. Ganesh sir. Thank you, Peter.
Thank you, dear professors. Let's move on to the main event. I take pleasure in inviting Dr. Avishek Parui, Associate Professor in English and Memory Studies, IIT Madras, and Associate Fellow, UK Higher Education Academy, to present the 12th T.G. Narayan Lecture on Memory Studies and Posthumanism, Research Possibilities and Praxis. Over to you, sir. Let's welcome, sir, with a huge round of applause.
Very good morning, and thank you very much for a very, very generous introduction. It's an absolute honor for me to be here. I'm very grateful to the organizing committee, the institute, such an august institute, Madras Christian College, for the honor of this invitation, and particularly thankful to Principal Wilson, Dr. Mekla Rajan. I think she was being very kind in the whole narrative about spelling. I think the email that she wrote to me is perhaps the more common spelling of my name. My parents just wanted to be more creative back in the day. And I continue to suffer that, even after so many years, but one learns to forgive their parents and move on. But thank you so much for this wonderful occasion. And I have been sort of requested, asked to speak about memory studies, particularly in the way it connects to post-humanism. But before I begin, I think I should tell this. I mean, I listened to Living Next Door to Alice after perhaps 25 years, thanks to all of you. So it just brought back many memories. So thank you for that beautiful song. Music obviously has a wonderful impact on memory. As we know, through empirical research, it can literally make you time travel. It can literally make you go back in time, come forward, resituate yourself. So I'll move on to the business of the day, which happens to be this endowment lecture, this very, very prestigious endowment lecture. I had the good fortune of speaking to Professor, the person in charge of endowment, the very, very generous benefactor, and it turned out that we have a Durham connection as well, which obviously makes it all the more beautiful and sweet and symbolic. Now, I will begin with a story which is political in quality in certain ways, but also funny, but it serves to illustrate a point that I hope to start with. I think it's important to illustrate this point, reinforce this point before we move on to what is memory studies and what is the role of literature in memory studies per se. So this is this may be familiar to many of you. Those of you who come from culture studies background would know this, but there's no harm in repeating a funny story. Humor always helps. So this is a story told by the famous critical theorist and philosopher Slavoj Žižek. Again, a very familiar name. Most of you read his works. This is from this book called The Aftermath of 9/11 that he wrote, which is called Welcome to the Desert of the Real, which is a line from the film Matrix, as some of you would know. So the story goes like this. It's a story about East Germany before the fall of the Berlin Wall. And it probably is apocryphal, but it helps to serve a point, illustrate a point. And the story is this. In East Germany, before the fall of the Berlin Wall, any person who would be suspected of any anti-state activity would be sent to a hard labor camp, not judged, not tried, just sent off to a hard labor camp. And of course, things would get worse from there. So one particular day, one man gets picked up. He's about to be sent to a hard labor camp because he's been suspected of doing something anti-state. The day before he leaves the hard labor camp, he sits down for one last dinner with his friends, and they decide to establish a code. He says, I'm going to write letters to you from the labor camp. But of course, because this is a labor camp, all the letters will be intercepted. They'll all read my letters, right? So how do I communicate to you? How do I write the real stuff to you, as it were? So let's establish a code. And the code is this. If I write a letter to you in blue ink, imagine everything I'm writing is correct, right? However, if I'm writing a letter to you in red ink, just invert the logic. So So for instance, if I'm writing a letter in blue ink saying, I am well, fine, everything is okay, it means I'm actually okay. However, if the same letter is written in red ink telling I am okay, it means something is deeply wrong. Just invert the logic. A month transpires, his friends receive a letter from him written in blue ink. And it goes like this. The labor camp is actually a good place. I am fine. I'm healthy. Things are fine over here. We play football on the weekends. There's films show every other Saturday. There's plenty of honey, butter. In fact, I don't know why people complain so much about the hard labor camp. We have everything we need to live a decent life, except one thing, we don't get red ink. Right. Now, all of you got what this means. Now, the important thing over here, and the reason why it's political, of course it's political at a very superficial level, but at a very semantic level, the reason why it is political at the level of representation monitored and pruned away. So even today, at 11 December, so I'm looking at the watch, it's 11, quarter past 11, you have already forgotten 70% of what you've done today. You have. And this isn't a source of fright or panic or disaster. This is just who you are. We are mammals who are hardwired to forget. Because the only way we can remember and move on is by forgetting. Now, there are extreme situations where, you know, there are medical studies where, for instance, a trauma victim, it is helpful to forget in certain ways. Sufferers of abuse, forgetting can become a coping mechanism in many ways, because you move on from that site of trauma. But even in quote-unquote normal memory processes, remembering and forgetting are connected categories, cognitively connected, functionally connected, etc. So that's paradox number one. Paradox number two, we tend to think of memory as essentially a retrospective activity. And we are right. So memory is about the past. We go back in time, bring back things of time, etc. However, memory is equally, perhaps if not more, a futuristic activity, an anticipatory activity. Now, again, I will look at the way in which almost everything I'm saying is valid at a molecular level as well as a cultural level, right? Because you remember your name, you remember your address, you remember your basic motor skills that will help you go back to your home today, right? You remember what you're supposed to do tomorrow. You remember the whole idea of prospective memory, right? So again, looking at how memory is not just retrospective but also prospective, looking forward in time. So we're looking at memory not just as an act of reconstruction, but also as an act of anticipation. What we remember shape what we're about to do. What you remember shape what we are sort of about to take action in. Now this can be, and also the first one, can be profoundly political in many ways. So now I'm moving to the macro dimension. So we've stuck to the micro dimension so far, the brain, synapses, you know, in terms of how we remember, forget information. What about politics? What about cultural memory? What about nation's memory? What about what we call history, right? Now, you know, I mean, it doesn't take a rocket scientist to understand, every one of us in the room would know this, that history is a contested activity. What gets in history, what doesn't get in history, these are very political decisions, right? So history is an act of encoding, sure, but also and equally is an act of erasure. Many things which are erased away in history. And every nation, irrespective of what it is, every nation will have this acts of erasure. The inglorious events will be forgotten. Must be forgotten, right? Now, I was fascinated when I learned that the benefactor of this endowment lecture was a correspondent of the Bengal famine. I come from Bengal. Obviously, I was born many, many years later after the famine happened. But it's really interesting even how, in terms of looking at how that particular event, Bengal famine, which perhaps killed more people than Auschwitz in many ways, has been forgotten. Right, even within our country. Forget about global attention. I mean, this is one of the interesting things about memory studies. When you start with memory studies, it is very, very dominated, and it should be, there's nothing wrong with that, with Holocaust studies, right, in terms of what happened in Second World War, in terms of the trauma, in terms of the brutal, barbaric activities, etc. And it's absolutely fine, right? It should study, it should engage with that. But what's interesting is that an equally disastrous massacre, and I use the word massacre very, very consciously, because as many of you know, the Bengal famine was hardly a natural famine, right? The Bengal famine was more, I mean, perhaps it'd be fairer to say it was entirely, almost entirely man-made, because the crops were siphoned off for the troops fighting the war, the civilians did not get the crops, under the direct instruction of Winston Churchill, and when the situation went out of hand, many of you know the story, when the situation was about to go out of hand, there was some media attention. It was getting so bad that, you know, global media was about to report on that. Churchill was asked whether they should release some crops now because it's getting embarrassing. You know, the dead children being pecked by vultures on the streets of Calcutta, the city where I grew up. And what was Churchill's reaction? I'm sure some of you would know this. If it is so bad, how come Gandhi is still alive? Let Gandhi die first and we release crops. And this is a man, ladies and gentlemen, who won the Nobel Prize for peace. This is a man who was consistently voted as the greatest Briton ever, even in most recent polls, ahead of Isaac Newton, ahead of William Shakespeare, ahead of David Beckham, right? The greatest Briton ever. Why? Because the way Churchill has been remembered for posterity was a guy who stopped Hitler, was a man who stopped the Nazis, right? Was a man who saved civilization. Now, what we're looking at here is how two different narratives of memory coming in. Let's just be very reductionist for a minute. The Bengal famine and Nazism. The two ways you can remember Churchill. How does he get to be remembered? Completely erasing the Bengal famine. Right? No one remembers Churchill for the Bengal famine. He is consistently voted as this decorated war general who saved civilization. Now, the point I'm trying to make, the example of Churchill is interesting because it consolidates both the paradoxes in a certain way. Every act of remembering also entails an act of forgetting. A. How you remember has almost nothing to do with the past. It has almost entirely to do with the future, right? Which is why you find that political memory is so important. I mean, why do you think certain figures, certain events, certain mythical areas across the world suddenly get remembered? Is it because politicians are very sentimental about the past? Perhaps not. But because it gives a toolkit to legitimize certain actions in the future. It gives a toolkit to instrumentalize policy, whether it's invasion, whether it's military invasion. There's a really interesting article on Putin's attack on Ukraine by James Wirtz called What is History? I invite all of you to read it. And it's a really fascinating article because it says right before the attack on Ukraine, the entire memory about Russia that was peddled by the Kremlin and other state sources was that the mother Russia is under attack. It has always been under attack. It is vulnerable. It is precarious. That memory of Russia being under attack was peddled again and again and again. Why? Because it would directly legitimize a foreign policy. It would directly legitimize military invasion. Because we're under attack, let's go attack somebody else and just reclaim our territory in a certain way, right? That's just one example. We can think of many examples across the world. Now, how does it all connect to the second aspect of my talk, which is about posthumanism, right? I mean, memory, we understand, operates through remembering and forgetting, retrospection, anticipation. It is molecular in quality, cultural in quality, sure. But how does it connect to the second aspect, which is posthumanism? Now, one of the things that I'm a little careful about while talking about posthumanism is that it is very easy to be seduced by posthumanism as something which happened last year. Right, it isn't. The sentiment of posthumanism, the attitude of what is posthumanism, is as ancient as human imagination. Let's try to understand the attitude of posthumanism. What is posthumanism? So posthumanism is a combination, and I'm being a little bit Wikipedia-ish over here for theoretical purposes, but I hope you'll forgive me and I hope it makes sense. Posthumanism may be understood as an attitudinal ambivalence, ambivalent attitude, because nested within posthumanism is a fantasy. Let's breed something better than humans. Let's breed something which is more powerful than humans. Let's do away with human. You know, human centricism must be done away with. Let's move on to the post-human, distributive, egalitarian perhaps, you know, less dominant by white male capitalists perhaps, etc. But something beyond the human, right? So there is this fantasy about that. There's also simultaneously embedded in the fantasy a phobia. Something better and stronger is coming to replace the humans. Now, this isn't new. And this is something I bore people with. Lots of people are demystified, maybe secretly hate me for it. Because I think every generation, every age, every culture, every epoch thinks it is uniquely ruined in certain ways, right? Now, we in a post-internet, post-digital world think we're uniquely ruined because, oh well, post-humanism, AI, algorithms, is taking over, sir. It's nothing new about that. The day that humans invented the wheel or a machine or anything resembling a machine, this ambivalence about fantasy and fear, let's invent something better than us, and the fear that that something better will replace us, it has been there in human imagination from the beginning of time. Renaissance theater is full of such examples, right? Mahabharata is full of such examples, right? The cyborg figure is nothing new, right? There are many examples of cyborgs across myths, across the world. Build something better than the human, right? That is the aspirational, fantastic part, the fantasy of something better than human. And the fantasy very quickly becomes phobia, the phobia becomes fantasy, it just becomes an asymmetric entanglement. Post-humanism, at a very sentimental level, is this asymmetric entanglement of fantasy and phobia. Something better than human, something superior to human, and yet something which can replace the human potentially. Right? Perhaps the finest novel written on post-humanism, Mary Shelley's Frankenstein, way before the internet was even conceived of. Right? Now, if you read Frankenstein, I'm sure most of you read Frankenstein, it is about this very, very male fantasy, Frankenstein. Let's do away with the one thing that man cannot do and woman can. Just that one thing. Well, men control property, men control the law, men control the language, men control politics, men control aspiration. There's one thing men can't do, right? Giving birth. There is the only one thing women can do, men can't. Let's do away with that as well. It's the ultimate fantasy, the ultimate male supremacist fantasy of coming up with a system that doesn't require women. That is the fantasy of Victor Frankenstein. That is the experiment of Victor Frankenstein. Of course, it goes horribly wrong. Perhaps it goes wrong because it is too successful. Right? If you read Frankenstein closely, the problem with the monster of Frankenstein is because it's too good. Right? He can read Milton from, he can hear Milton from outside a room and understand original sin. He can hear John Locke from outside a room and understand philosophy. Right? He's way better than humans, and that is the problem. Right? So the monstrosity in Mary Shelley's Frankenstein is also because of its sublimity. It's a sublime monstrous. It's just too good, right? Now, this, again, this is classic post-humanism. You make something, you want to make something which is better than human. It becomes too good, that becomes a problem. Now, I just give an example of a biopolitical example of that. Let's stick to a very political example, just a political example. You want to create an agent which will run your system perfectly, right? Now, the agent becomes more powerful than a system. Now, the system has to send someone to kill the agent. Heart of Darkness, Joseph Conrad, right? The idea of Kutz, General Kutz, the perfect soldier of the empire. The all of Europe, if you read Heart of Darkness, the all of Europe contribute to the making of Kutz. It's almost like a cyborg, right? Now, he's too good an agent now. He wants to run his own empire now. So the empire has to send someone to kill him, which becomes this fantastic film as well. Some of you have seen it, Apocalypse Now, which is loosely based on the Vietnam War, right? Again, Zizek has an article on Kutz where he talks exactly about that, you know, this idea of the post-human. You make something better than the system, and now it's a problem for the system, right? Okay, so I think I hope to establish to a certain extent that the whole idea of post-humanism, it relies on an aspiration, which is also an anxiety. It relies on a fantasy, which is also a phobia in many ways, right? So like memory, post-humanism too, it's full of contradictions, which are not actually contradictions. So these are tensions which become what the system is. So memory is a constant interplay of remembering and forgetting. Post-humanism similarly may be described as an interplay of anxiety and aspiration, fantasy and phobia. Now let's come to our age today and find out how we are uniquely ruined. Like you said, that, you know, all age wants to describe itself as uniquely ruined. If you read romantic poetry, the poet then says, oh, well, this is all over. Industrial revolution has happened. We're just going to die very soon. You know, chimneys are coming. Trees are being cut. That survived. And then Matthew Arnold came towards the end of the 19th century and said, well, this is it. The sea of fate was once too at its full. Now I can just hear the retreating roar, et cetera, et cetera. And there's nothing, I'm not making fun of this, but because this is a very natural human imagination, right? The whole ability of the imagination to sort of cite the precarity of existence, right? That's the whole role of the poet, so to speak, right? To find out, to prophesy the precarity, to foresee the precarity in a certain sense. But it's also useful to situate precarity, so situated precarity in a certain sense. So how is memory and post-humanism uniquely welded, uniquely tied, uniquely connected in a, what we call the post-digital age? Now, first of all, what is post-digital, right? What is the term post-digital? Post-digital may be defined as that condition in which digitality is not something outside of you. Digitality is you. You are the digital, right? Now, I just went to a recent workshop on translation some time ago. I'm not an expert in translation studies. I have no idea what invited me, so I went. But while talking about translation, I sort of came up with this idea, obviously during conversation with colleagues, it was entirely because the inputs they were giving, it wasn't my idea. But the whole notion that in a post-digital age, you also become acronyms in certain sense, right? You become digital markers in a certain sense. You have a username, right? You are a username, right? If you're using UPI, you are something at the rate, right? If you're using Amazon, if you're using Swiggy, if you're using any of the apps, if you're using Uber, you have a username. The translation of the biological to the digital, right, is not something which is fantastic anymore. It's profoundly domestic, right? And this domestication of the digital is something which is really unique. Now, that is unique, one has to admit, the domestication of the digital. Now, everyone, now we talk about digital literacy. Now, you might find 100 people who have never heard of John Keats or William Wordsworth, but it's very difficult to find someone who doesn't have an UPI, right? So there are different kinds of literacy that are happening today, right? So digital literacy obviously is a big thing. Now, suppose digital. Suppose digital may be defined as a condition where digitality is the norm. The subject is a digital already, always already digital in a certain sense, right? So what happens to post-digital memory? How do you define memory in a post-digital age? And then post-digital slash post-human age. Now, we came up in our Center for Memory Studies, some of you may know this, with two apps. One is called Memory Bytes, which was a digitization of 500 years of Anglo-Indian history in India. So you can download it if you just go to Google Play Store. It's a free app. So it's just called Memory Bytes, B-Y-T-E-S. The second one, which is a pilot project at the moment, is Moving Memory, right? Moving Memory is more ambitious. You can't download it yet because it's not ready yet. It is a kind of app which is supposed to give you the experience of remembering in a certain way. Memory Bytes is more data-centric. You get to know about the digital reconstruction of Anglo-Indians, etc. But the reason why I'm mentioning these two is because the ontology of memory has changed post-digital age. The nature of memory has changed in a post-digital age. Now, related to nature is the necessity of memory. Now, I think I belong to that unique generation, which was uniquely ruined in many ways, because our generation, I'm sure there are many people in my age range in this room, I'm just trying to be exclusive, but our generation actually saw the internet come, right? We saw the internet come, like we saw what was internet, we saw that monstrosity coming and domesticating and taking over, etc., etc. Now, obviously, as a middle class boy growing up in Calcutta, I saw the transition from taking an auto and going to what was called the internet parlor back in those days. Internet cafes, parlors, very shady places where you pay 25, 30 rupees an hour and you don't do JSTOR over there, right? But the whole point is that the whole idea of the internet is something else. You're going out to access the world out there. From there, the gradual transition of the internet to your phone. Everyone has internet, right? But that was rapid. That took place in 10 years, maybe even less up, right? Now, why am I mentioning this? And why? How is it related to, what I just said about the necessity of memory? So when you say ontology of memory, it's also about necessity to memory, because memory surely is also functional. You need to remember information, right? Otherwise, you can't get work done. Now, before the whole idea of the mobile phone came into being, I personally could remember at least 20 phone numbers. At least 20 phone numbers. I had to, because there was no other option. 20 phone numbers, you know, neighbors, friends, relatives, etc. Now, the only number I remember is my wife's. Sometimes I forget that too, right? Because I don't need to. Why not? Because memory is now a profoundly prosthetic activity. There are machines which remember for you. You know, your phone will beep up and say, well, today is your anniversary. Your phone will beep up and say, you have a Google meeting today. Your phone will beep up and say, there's someone's birthday today. So the whole distributive quality of memory, memory is outside of the body now. Memory is prosthetic. The inactive, extended quality of memory in a post-digital age. Now that is a very, very radical phenomenon, the radical alteration of memory. And that is connected to the requirement of memory. You don't need to remember anything. There are machines remembering for you. Imagine a world, dark, dystopian world, one day, I hope that it never happens, touch wood, where what we call internet shuts down for one day across the world. Imagine a situation. It's almost impossible to imagine it, right? The situation where what we call internet shuts down for a day. Now, the younger ones over here, most of you are younger than me, are just laughing at me. It was this, you know, silly rattle going on, this old man. But I am saying this because, like many people of my generation, there are people who are older than me as well, I saw the thing come, right? I saw the arrival of the internet from the distant internet parlor to the bulky personal computer in the room, to the pager, to the bulky mobile phone, to the slim mobile phone, to a part of your body, to a wristwatch, etc., etc., etc. The increasing miniaturization of memory, the increasing transition of memory from bulky, heavy machines to essentially your fingernail, right? So that transition we saw, right? So it is perhaps not entirely impossible for us to sort of imagine a situation where that thing called the internet is shut down for a day. That thing called the virtual world is shut down for a day. Now that would have profound repercussions on memory, on what you remember, how you remember, etc. Imagine a world where all the usernames are forgotten, all your passwords are forgotten, right? It's very dark, right? But the whole point of this exercise is that memory, the way we process memory today, or experience memory today in a post-human, post-digital world, where the borderline between the other definition of post-human, of course, the borderline between the man and the machine is increasingly blurring away, et cetera, et cetera. Memory today is a very interstitial activity. It's a plastic activity. It's an interfacial activity. Memory doesn't require a pure body anymore. Memory can occupy boundaries and spread across boundaries, right? So the entire, again, this is connected to the way we consume knowledge today. This is connected to the way we process knowledge today. Production, consumption, processing of knowledge has also changed, right? The massive velocity of knowledge, the, you know, again, if you stick to academic exercise for 1 minute, imagine a world, and I think some of our senior colleagues over here can imagine it perfectly well. Imagine a world where in order to access one article for doing a PhD, you have to go to a library in some other city, take permission through a paper slip, wait for a week, and then perhaps have to write it down because, hello, there's no Xerox machine, right? Imagine what people did research once upon a time. That was research, right? And now, obviously, you can just click your phone and JSTOR opens up, Project Muse opens up. You can download N number of articles in research in your mobile phones, and that is research. So what I'm trying to tell is the materiality of technology also affects the abstract workings of the brain. So it's not just enough to say, well, mobile phones and, you know, all these fancy machines are there. All these fancy machines are the materiality of memory. And the materiality of memory also affects what we call the ephemerality of memory. So memory isn't really ephemeral. It is not something inside your head. It is inside and outside. It's a constant traffic, a constant loop, a constant interplay of outside and inside. And one philosopher I find very interesting in this regard is someone called Andy Clark. Now, Andy Clark is a cognitive philosopher who works on cognition. He has a 4E model of cognition. He talks about cognition as a 4E model: embedded, embodied, extended, and active. And at any given time, all these four must be in interplay with each other. Embedded, you have neurons, your fibers, your muscles is embedded. Embodied, you have a body, but it doesn't stop there. You have to enact that through language, through cultural practices, and you have to extend that through machines, through technology, etc. So embodied, embedded, extended, and active. All four must operate together. Right. So the prosthetic quality of memory, the entire post-digital quality of memory, Which brings us to my second last point, and I'm going to wind up from now. Those of you who are bored should cheer up. So the whole idea of looking at memory in the current situation, and how does one look at identity? All right, so what is identity? And this is something that I teach in my culture studies course as well. So the argument is this. When we look at identity politics today, right, it's not just enough to say that you have a linguistic identity, you have a cultural identity, you have a religious identity, you have an ethnic identity. Of course you do. There's one more dimension. You also have an algorithmic identity. You are what you purchase at Amazon. You are what you eat at Zomato. You are what you pay in UPI. You also have that footprint, right? And someone is remembering it. All that data, all that consumption, what you ate last night by ordering something, that memory doesn't go away. And that is the other thing about the digital memory. There is something deathless about the digital. Nothing really dies in the digital. And I have this really fancy idea, which I hope to translate into a paper someday. The correlation between the deathless digital and Dorian Gray, the picture Dorian Gray, right? That image which doesn't grow old, right? That image which will always resurface and stay exactly what it is, timeless, frozen image, right? And nothing really goes away in the digital. So, and that again is quite political and not just being fancy over here. You know, as you all know, there are, you know, the whole idea of organizational power today is investment in knowledge. So if company A wants to shame someone in company B, dig up some old tweet, dig up some old image of someone doing something embarrassing, and keep circulating that, right? Because it doesn't go away, right? It stays. You know, there's a deathless quality about the digital. But the point is, when we do cultural studies today, as students of cultural studies like ourselves, we must start engaging with the whole idea of algorithmic identity, right? What are you as an algorithm? What is a digital footprint? What kind of navigation do you do in terms of production, consumption, processing of knowledge? Now, the last bit. The big thing, the big elephant in the room, the big elephant in almost any discussion today, artificial intelligence, ChatGPT, right? The bane of teachers, the false promise for students, the rabbit hole for researchers, et cetera, ChatGPT, and many other things. You know, a software which can write a love letter, a software which can write a poem, a software which can write articles, letters, whatever. I haven't tried it yet, but I'm sure many of you have. And obviously the response is, again, going back to the whole idea of fantasy and fear, aspiration and anxiety. Everything is embedded, and ChatGPT is just one example. So what happens to memory in a time of artificial intelligence, right? It sounds a bit like love in the time of cholera, right? What happens to memory in a time of artificial intelligence, right? Does memory stay organic? Is it completely inorganic? Is it completely prosthetic? Is it completely plastic? Or is it a little bit of everything, right? Now, obviously, again, this is not something unique to us. This acceleration outside the body has been happening since the beginning of time. The printing press, for instance, right? When the printing press came into being, there was equal phobia about the printing press. When a camera came into being, there was equal phobia about the camera. When the cinema came into being, and all technological interventions have had the circulation of fantasy and phobia, anxiety and aspiration, etc. But there is something unique about artificial intelligence, right? One has to admit. And that uniqueness, obviously, is its ability to simulate humanness, right? Simulation. Now, notice I'm using a very technical term. You know, I'm not using mimesis, for example. I'm using simulation, and there's a difference. I'll come back to that, right? Simulation. It can simulate reality. It can simulate thought processes. It can simulate data. And a large part of artificial intelligence, if you notice, you know, if you really study the investment in artificial intelligence across the world, I mean, where is the maximum money pumped in artificial intelligence? The maximum money is pumped in trying to calibrate predictive behavior, predictive patterns. Now, if we can figure out a way how the consumer, what the consumer will buy tomorrow, that's it, right? If we can figure out a pattern, what the consumer will invest tomorrow, that's it, right? Then they can, you keep feeding that to the consumer. And obviously the consumer will keep buying that, right? So that is the data. So you wonder, right? I mean, sometimes all of us wonder, why are companies interested to know our banal data, like what I ate last night? Why are companies interested for the banal data where I went an Uber And the response to that is, there is this effort to simulate a pattern, right? So each individual self, each individual subject must be translated into a pattern. And that pattern must be predictive in quality, right? So predictive intelligence. So AI, the really hot AI, as in where the maximum money is pumped in, where you know major companies are funding, investing, etc., in terms of R&D research, is predictive AI, the AI which will predict certain things. Now, of course, a large part of that is wonderful. A large part of that can be used for magnificent causes, disaster management, weather forecast, share market forecast. So lots of things in AI are really, really useful. I mean, it's impossible to imagine a world where these things go away. And again, what I'm cautioning against over here towards the end is not to take a simplistic attitude towards technology. It is not utopia, it is not dystopia. It's like everything, a little bit of everything, right? A bit of both, an asymmetric entanglement, shall we say. Now, what happens to the human? That is the final question. What happens to human memory in the time of post-humanism? What happens, so let's say AI goes on the way it is going on and ChatGPT becomes more sophisticated, we teachers run into more trouble, we grade in a very confused way, we give A and S to people who just simulate something from software, et cetera, et cetera. Very, very dark times ahead of us, but what happens to the human? What happens to human memory? What happens to, would there be anything, let's phrase it differently, and perhaps a little bit philosophically, would the ontology of humanness be human in the time of AI, right? Would there be something purely human at the time of artificial intelligence? Now, I will end my talk with somewhat of a shock, somewhat of a paradox, perhaps, right? And this is, again, from neuroscience in a certain way. And this is a fantastic book called Anxious by a fantastic neuroscientist called Joseph Ledoux, L-E-D-O-U-X. Right? So Ledoux is famous for his work on anxiety. He works on amygdala. Amygdala is the emotional center of the brain. Amygdala and hippocampus are constantly interacting with each other. Hippocampus is the memory center. But the reason why we tend to remember something that we're emotionally invested in more is because if amygdala and hippocampus interact with each other, the memory becomes stronger, which is why you remember pleasant memories more than the guy you saw in a supermarket next to you. Right? You don't remember it because it doesn't affect you emotionally, right? So emotional memories tend to have a deeper imprint. And the reason behind that is amygdala and hippocampus, when they are in loop with each other, maximum memory encoding happens. So that's the technical bit. But this book called Anxious by Joseph Ledoux, it talks about anxiety as a cultural phenomenon. Right? The constant consumption of anxiety, obviously, you know, very serious mental health situations today. You know, the whole idea of anxiety in terms of, you know, different kinds of anxiety, share market anxiety, academic anxiety, professional anxiety, personal anxiety, etc. But the reason why this book is really, really interesting is, like, somewhat like the attitude I'm taking today, it doesn't look at anxiety today as a unique phenomenon. In fact, the argument of the book is really interesting and refreshingly radical, and that is, anxiety is a part of our evolutionary toolkit. If we were not anxious, we would not have evolved as mammals, as Homo sapiens. Now, why so, you'd ask? Surely, I mean, if you do away with anxiety, you know, life is better, life is sweeter, more pleasant, etc. So that is just nonsense, you'd say. The argument is this, and it's a very sophisticated argument, which is very poetically put. Ledoux says this, and it sounds almost like John Keats. The line is, anxiety is a price that a human brain has to pay for its ability to anticipate the future. I'll say it one more time. Anxiety is a price that a human brain has to pay for its ability to anticipate the future. Now, why are we anxious? We are anxious because we're running different simulations in the head, different scenarios. Well, scenario A fails, scenario B fails, scenario C maybe works, doesn't work. So anxiety is, you're throwing a loop ahead in time, and it throws back at you, and that calibration between the forward-looking projectile quality of imagination and the retrospective quality of imagination. So it is a very, very sophisticated mechanism, like empathy. Like empathy. And many of you know empathy. Empathy, again, as some of you know, is the ability to imagine yourself as someone else. It's not sympathy, by the way. Very different, right? Sympathy is, I am who I am, and I'm doing charity, and I'm feeling superior about it. That's great. Right? Who wouldn't want that? Empathy is, I am not who I am anymore. I am the suffering subject. I have become that. Now that requires a very, very complex motor mechanism. That requires a very, very complex neural mechanism in the prefrontal cortex. Only humans have it to that sophisticated degree. There are lots of interesting research on monkeys as well. Anyway, so empathy, anxiety, right? Now empathy is obviously, you can say, well, one perhaps may come to a time, one perhaps may come to a AI-driven narrative where it is possible for a machine to simulate so well, so sophisticatedly, that it can begin to be something else. That is imaginatively possible. It hasn't happened yet, but it is imaginatively possible. But ironically, the one thing, the one human thing, which is protecting us from AI, which is making us still unique from AI in many ways, is anxiety. So anxiety, ladies and gentlemen, is an ability. It's an ability because it comes with the price you have to pay to anticipate the future. We don't have an anxious robot yet. We don't have an anxious AI machine yet, right? And unless we have that, unless we come to that, I think there is a certain degree of uniqueness that human being can still sort of retain. The second point, and this is the last point, another A, which is a very unique human point, and that A is a darling of literature, ambivalence, right? What is ambivalence? It is not uncertainty, by the way. It is not uncertainty. Ambivalence, if you remember your class six chemistry, valence is valency, value, ambi is both. Both values are equally valid and equally present. It is not an either or. It's just the opposite of the computer language. It is ontologically opposite to the binary logic of zero or one. It is zero and one. Both can be equally valid. Ambivalence. So ambivalence, again, which can translate into uncertainty. It is not uncertainty, but can translate into uncertainty, is again a very, very human aspect. We don't quite have an ambivalent AI yet, just like we don't have an ambivalent or anxious AI yet. I'll end with this, last metrics, right? How much energy does a human brain require today, even now, I mean, always has been, to do all this stuff? Be anxious, be ambivalent, fall in love, write a poem, worry about AI, make sense of the world. How much energy does a human brain need? Can anyone answer that? 17 watt, less than a light bulb, 1/7. To even imagine an AI which can do all that, right, would require an energy system which is absolutely untenable. So my proposition is, let's stick to our 17 watts for as long as we can. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor Avishek Parui. Thank you so much for taking us through the trajectory of what memory studies is and how it is correlated with literature. Here are some lines which gave us a lot of insights, shared with us the role of absence and liminal statements in the essence of literature, and how literature is a linguistic representation of all that is liminal and how literature defamiliarizes reality. Shared with us the significance of the unconscious memory as an act of anticipation and shaping agent, and the macro dimensions of memory related to politics, culture, history, and nation, and many, many more. You took us through a world into the world of posthumanism, and this is such an amazing lecture. Let's put our hands together and thank Dr. Avishek Parui for his amazing lecture this morning. As we move on, ladies and gentlemen, we have the announcement of the T.G. Narayanan Endowment Essay Competition. Under the aegis of T.G. Narayanan Endowment, we have the essay competitions conducted annually. And to announce the prize winners, I'm going to invite Dr. Anne Thomas, Associate Professor of the Department of English. Welcome, ma'am.
Good afternoon, everyone. In fact, I'm stepping to fill in the vacuum left by Dr. Samuel Rufus, who is supposed to take up this responsibility. And let me also thank the donor, Dr. Ranganarayanan, for sponsoring the prizes. for the annual essay competitions for the second MA students. Let me take the pleasure to mention the winners of the TG Narayanan essay competition. The third place goes to Mr. Kevin of second MA English. May I request Dr. Avishek Parui to do the honors? Congratulations, Kevin, and thank you, sir. The second place goes to Ms. Neha Dominic of second MA English, and may I request Dr. Ranganarayanan to give away the prize. Ms. Neha Dominic. And the first place goes to Mr. Sharan Srinivas of second MA English. May I request both the chief guest and Dr. Ranganarayanan, the donor, to together give away the prize. Congratulations, Sharan. Thank you, sirs. The following students from second MA English get special prizes. Anderlin Victor. May I request Dr. K. Ganesh, the former head of the department of the Department of English, to give away the prize. Anderlin Victor, special prize. Miss Vivilia. May I request Professor Charyan Kurian to give away the prize to Ms. Vivilliam, special prize. The next special prize goes to Ms. Jess Sudha. May I request Dr. Nirmal Selvamani, the former professor of the Department of English, to hand over the certificate. Last but not the least, one more special prize to Ms. Dhana Vaishnavi, and may I request the current head of the Department of English, Dr. Meghla Rajan, to hand over the certificate to Ms. Dhana Vaishnavi. Congratulations to all the winners, and thank you, sirs and ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am. Ladies and gentlemen, we're going to have a book release now. We are so excited because it is a book by our own student, our second BA English student, Mr. T. Abraham. It is a poetry book titled I Admire You, A Self-Admiration of My Inner Feelings. It's a compilation of 50 poems written by Abraham. I'm going to request our respected speaker, Dr. Avishek Parui, to release the book, and the first copy would be received by our head of the department, Dr. Meghla Rajan. Abraham. Of the department, Dr. Meghla Rajan, will receive the first copy. thank Dr. Samuel Rufus and all the department staff for encouraging Abraham in this endeavor. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, sirs. A very endearing person whose love for reading and learning from a variety of knowledge domains is unmatched by her expertise in creative conceptualization. Professor Pristina Dhanasekaran established a vibrant and dynamic journal, Cornucopia, exclusively for students to provide an opportunity for their creative expressions. May I invite Professor Pristina to share a few words and take over the release of the latest issue of the journal, Cornucopia. A round of applause.
Thank you so much, everyone. I have a cyclone in my throat, so apologies. Cornucopia, the horn of plenty. Emblematic of the abundance of talents that we have. This is an exclusive magazine for students to publish their creative works, their artworks, the text, everything with an ISBN. So it's my privilege to witness along with you all the fifth edition of Cornucopia. And I'd like to introduce you to my team. This year's student editorial team comprises Leka, Ilfa, and Catherine of First BA. If you guys could just come up front. We'll have the release very soon. Priyadashini of 3rd BA and Alan PGC Research Scholar. They've edited and enhanced the myriad entries from our department students as well as other entries we received from friends from other departments. Kudos to the wonderful feat that you guys have done in weaving together this aesthetic tapestry. My special thanks to my dear friend and colleague, Professor John Jabajay Singh. Is he around? Please come up to the front for overseeing the printing of these creative dreams. I thank my beloved teachers and my colleagues profusely for their unwavering support and goodwill towards this endeavor. And thank you to all my former professors as well. Without you, no one would be here. Much gratitude to our dynamic head of the department, who's always been a vibrant source of positivity, guidance, and purposeful support. I now request our esteemed chief guest to release the first copy of the magazine, and I request Dr. Ranga Narayan to receive the same.
Sirs, as we have come to the end of today's program, I'm going to request the treasurer of the Department of English, our Professor Aruna Ma'am, to kindly come forward and propose a word of thanks.
Quote and unquote George Herbert, O thou who has given us so much mercifully, grant us one more thing, a grateful heart. Complying with this dictum, and on behalf of the PG and Research Department of English, Madras Christian College, I extend my sincere thanks to the Secretary and Principal Dr. P. Wilson for his unwavering support in all our academic pursuits. My profoundest gratitude to our resource person, Dr. Avishek Parui, for his insightful lecture on memory studies and posthumanism. Sir, it was more than a panoptic view wherein the research aspirants would have really been enthused into selecting memory studies as a research area. Thank you very much, sir. Payan Tukar Seida Udavi, Nayan Tukin, நன்மை கடலின் பெரிது. திருக்குறள் ஃபெமிலியராக இல்லாதவங்களுக்கு டிரான்ஸ்லேஷன் இருக்கு. த டிரான்ஸ்லேஷன் கோஸ் திஸ் வே: வென் யூ பாண்டர் ரைட் த மெரிட் ஆஃப் த கைண்ட்னஸ் ஷோன் பை தோஸ் ஹூ வெய் நாட் த ரிட்டர்ன், இட் இஸ் வாஸ்டர் தேன் த சி. திஸ் ரெஃபர்ஸ் டு நன் அதர் தேன் தி எனார்மஸ் கைண்ட்னஸ் ஷோன் பை ஆர் டிஸ்டிங்விஷ் ப்ரொஃபஸர் டாக்டர் ரங்கநாராயணன், அண்ட் த டிபார்ட்மெண்ட் ஓஸ் இட்ஸ் ஸ்பெஷல் தேங்க்ஸ் டு ஹிம் ஹூ மேக்ஸ் அன் ஏர்னஸ்ட் அட்டெம்ப்ட் டு அட்டெண்ட் த எண்டோமென்ட் லெக்சர் எவ்ரி இயர். சார், இட் இஸ் ஆல்மோஸ்ட் லைக் அ ரிலேட்டிவ் விசிட்டிங் அஸ் எவ்ரி இயர். தேங்க் யூ வெரி மச் சார். And in fact, I seize this opportunity on behalf of all my friends in the department to express our wholehearted thanks to our head of the department, Dr. Meghla Rajan, who has been striding us through with only love and camaraderie as our magic wand. A democratic leader in the truest sense of the word, I thank you, ma'am. The department is thankful to all our respected former professors, Dr. Nirmal sir, Dr. Cherian sir, Dr. Ganesh sir, whose ready guidance and legacy steers us through all our achievements. Thank you, dear sirs. I extend my sincere thanks to all our special guests who have been sharing the joy of our success on all occasions. Our thanks is due to the teaching fraternity from various other colleges and from the other departments of Madras Christian College. Thank you, dear sirs and ma'am. The stakeholders, the students who need to fully realize the importance of such academic pursuits, and hoping that you would have made effective use of this knowledge-sharing platform to the fullest, I thank you, my dear students, for your patient listening, and I hope you all take this as a cue for your research project also. Finally, I do thank all the technical and support staff who has helped us throughout. Thank you, one and all. And sorry, I need to thank my department, my family English department, for their unwavering support in all the occasions. Thank you very much.
Friends, with that we come to the end of the 12th TG Narayanan Endowment Lecture. Thank you for your patience and your participation. See you all next year. Until then, God be with you and God bless you. Here signing off, Dr. Phoebe and Professor Arun. Tea and refreshment is provided outside. I kindly request